have been to a COSA before. Most fans. For those who have not, we host a series in the library every week because we see it as an extension of our charge to promote the freedom of information and open exchange of ideas. Whether or not you agree with every single thing you hear in this session or find in the books that are available for checkout up here, or read in our dailies, we want everyone to have a wide range of perspectives to learn and grow from. So, at the end of this, I'll fill out a very brief survey asking what you liked, how we can keep this relevant to you all in the future, what topics you'd like to see. And if you are passionate about a topic and want to lead a session, come talk to me or Dave or Lisa, any of the three of us, right? Next week, Sahira Barajas will be leading a session on immigrants' rights. But today, please join me in welcoming Katie Chenu, Environmental Sciences faculty, and
I think I know most of you. This is a small audience. A lot of people all work in the library. And I have to say, did you work in the library?
No.
Thank you. Thank you for being here. I wanted to say that I feel like this is where the climate discussion is right now, that it's very alienating for a lot of people. And Alicia, my close colleague, another person who's here, made a comment about this climate reality leadership title, which is Al Gore started this leadership training, in 2006 when his original movie came out. And I went through the recent leadership training in Bellevue, and we were at many of the film releases for his most recent film. Did anyone see his most recent film, An Inconvenient Sequel? No, and that was the thing. It's like no one was in the theaters. The theaters were empty. We don't want to think about climate change, and honestly, I don't want to think about climate change, and I don't want to talk about climate change anymore. Has anyone seen Bill Nye? He's got a new release of his show from way back when. And the first episode was outstanding, and it was all these simple experiments about climate change. And he brought, at the end, he brought out this really famous actor whose name I can't remember, and they have this whole conversation about how they don't feel like talking about climate change anymore. It's kind of old news. And yet, here I am, continuing to talk about it. So I don't feel like talking about it, but I think it's really important. So I really appreciate you all being here. I have over 100 slides, and there's no way I can do that. Sitting, but I have so much to say and to explore about this topic right now. And I'll warn you all that I also feel really emotional about this topic right now, because my kind of action plan for climate change for myself is to kind of step out of my comfort zone. That's my current. So this is me, and I'm stepping out of my comfort zone, and I'm being filmed, and I'm in the library, talking to people I don't really know. And I feel really comfortable showing graphs and numbers. That's my comfort zone. That makes me very happy. And now I've just started to place myself out of my comfort zone in all kinds of places, like at movie releases and handing things out on the streets, and having these strange conversations where I don't know where they're going. So that's why the second slide on here was that I could also title this Katie Chenu's Existential Crisis, but I don't think anyone would come to that talk. Adam, did you want to say something about, I don't know if we have any students.
Yeah.
Any?
Are there any students in here? No. I'm Adam Auer, District Sustainability Coordinator, and we have Sustainability Council here at Seattle Central, and so we're recruiting students. We'd love more students to be part of that group. That group does a lot of things on campus, sustainability related. We help plan Earth Week last year. We're trying to put up more waste signs. You might have noticed some more posters around your waste bins, and we're trying to get better bin locations and all that kind of stuff, along with other things. We're focusing on waste this year, for the most part, but we'll entertain other ideas, especially if there's support from faculty. So if you are a faculty member or staff and you have ideas or interests, we can talk afterwards, or just send me a note at sustainability@seattlecollege.edu.
Thank you. Okay. So I didn't know what to call this talk, so I called it climate justice because that's something that I'm exploring right now as I get out of my comfort zone, out of the science side of things. The climate part of that I'm very comfortable with, but it's the justice part that I'm trying to wrap my head around to incorporate into my teaching and just in my life in general. So I thought maybe we could take a moment to try and define what climate justice is and how we're gonna do that more out of my comfort zone. I'm gonna play a song for you guys. I'm not gonna sing it. I'm gonna play a song for you guys. And this is a song that makes me cry every time. And if you guys have been on the second floor of the Science and Math Building, you might have heard it because I'm trying to play it over and over to desensitize myself to it for this talk today. Because there's one scene in there where I feel like it is my daughter when she is older and she's looking at me and she is angry and she is like, what the fuck? Like, she's looking at me and she's angry about the climate issue. And I'm just terrified of it. I have my kids in my locket here. I carry them around. And I think about this all the time for the climate issue. So I put some whiteboards. I stole Leisha's whiteboards. I put some whiteboards on the tables. And I'm going to play this song. I'm going to try not to get upset. And I put some markers for you guys to just write down ideas. All alone over here. Leisha, you're welcome. For you guys to just write down some ideas, incomplete, that come up for you. While you're watching this, and what you think climate justice is, or even just the concept of justice right now. Okay, so I'll go over. Okay, and this song is part. It was written for an Inconvenient sequel. So there's some scenes from that. We see a whole variety of images. So I'll just play this. I try to incorporate music and art into my classes more and more. I really don't know much about it, but it's getting the message across much better than my graphs are. So I held it together. Can you guys talk with your table a little bit? I don't see anything on the whiteboard, but if you guys can write down any words or I like to have the whiteboards just to like focus everyone's attention at the same place, but if you guys could try and just think about this term a little bit and what that actually means. What ideas came up for you? Feel free to introduce yourselves to the people at your table.
Hi, my name is Adam.
Hi.
Storms, fires,
it's like a
stream.
A lot of times in the news, gender, race, religion, put ourselves in buckets and try to. It seems like it's not consistently possible to try to figure out how to deliver it. You know, if you want to play climate change, a lot of people have been involved in it.
We had a song, and it was just a feeling about that song. don't know if you're off, but I'm having some mild question.
So this is kind of intended, and I should be sure it's actually the first one. Thanks for the effort to see how we're doing. At least as this was, they were just not talking about that. There was one policy that was so specific to go around and embarrass, go through, So that people are really sick of talking about it, and nothing's happening.
Let's come back together. Let's hold these ideas that you guys have that you're writing down on the whiteboards, and we'll come back to those. I want to talk just a little bit more. Well, first of all, so justice is defined as what's morally right and what's fair. And when I was exploring this, it was one of those answers that then leads to more questions, where then you end up going and looking at more words. And I'm thinking of what's right and what's fair. So I want to talk a little bit more about the fight for climate justice, where that is right now. And then at the end, this can be kind of like a choose your own adventure. I'm taking a language class right now, and someone asked, what is a topic that you could talk about without any practice training for 40 minutes? It's climate change. I could talk about that. This could be a 5-hour workshop, so we can make this kind of a choose your own adventure in so many different directions. But I want to just talk a little bit about the fight. A little bit, and then we could decide where we want to go. And there are just some images that I've been starting to use in my classes. I'm transforming all my classes. I teach earth science, but it seems like you can't just talk about science anymore once you have 7.5 billion people around the planet and things are really crumbling. You have to pull in the humanity side of things too. So I use a lot of art and pictures and music in my classes, which I said I know nothing about, to think about what justice is. And as you guys are seeing in the news, you know, the fight right now is really about not allowing any new carbon frontiers, no more carbon into the atmosphere. And there are thousands of people around the world that are putting their bodies in the way of this carbon being extracted. At the Dakota Access Pipeline was one of the most recent big protests that you guys probably saw. And we saw, you know, forest removal of peaceful protesters. And in Canada, I don't know if anyone's followed movements there, but huge groups of people, many Native peoples, putting their bodies in the way. This is a really famous protest against hydraulic fracturing. And we can just see the power difference here. All women of color placed a single feather at the feet of the police, and they all went to jail. Stuff going on right now. And in the US, we have this crazy thing, you know, you guys are seeing this, where we have this kind of attention grabbing, look over here, this is crazy over here, I'm going to put out these crazy tweets, and you don't know what's going on. It's very shocking, and you're trying to keep up with what's going on day to day, while at the same time, we have some really significant things that are going on. About in the first 100 days, there were 25 environmental rules that were overturned very quickly. Big things, all the way from reusable water bottles for national parks to, look at number one, flood building standards, and going back to older zoning in many places around the U.S. so that we can build in flood zones. It's crazy. whole big list here. I just put this link up here. I don't know if we can share this part, but Naomi Klein has some wonderful books about economy and policy and climate change. And she has this, she was in an interview, she wrote about this concept called the shock doctrine. She said, no, we're like the shock doctrine. Like everything's turned upside down now, where we have this big, you know, very distracting thing going on in the White House, when really a lot of things, especially for climate change, are being turned upside down. These are the 27 environmental plans that are being phased out right now, turned over right now. The Clean Power Plan is the one that's in the news right now. And the Clean Power Plan just says that states have the right to choose how they would like to reduce their emissions. So it's a really free-form, states first, pro-economy approach to reducing carbon. And at the same time, we have our head of the EPA building himself a soundproof booth so he can arrange how he can take money from private industry to overturn these rules. So it seems like, you know, for me, like I said, I don't like to talk about myself, but this talk is really about my existential crisis. And I feel like I really want to ignore all these things, but I just, you know, I can't stand back anymore thinking about all these things. And another reason why I'm so emotional about this, on April 20th, I don't know if anyone went to that cozy talk, but that was Michael Foster, and he was in this room. And I was sitting over there, and he talked about how he was part of this protest, turning off tar sands oil into coming into the U.S. And he was just found guilty on almost all counts in North Dakota for his peaceful protest of turning off that pipeline. And Michael, I feel like I'm, you know, walking in his shoes. I just wrote him a letter yesterday where he had this comfortable job, but he has these kids and he knows this issue. It's bad, and so he started telling people about the science of it, and then he started doing some more action, and now he's probably going to jail for 20 years. I don't want to go to jail for 20 years, but we've got to do something about this. And the crazy thing about this, did anyone follow this news? The crazy thing about this was that they were in five different states, and all of the people who turned off these tar sands pipelines said they were going to use this necessity defense, which says the climate is changing. We are required to do something in order to avoid greater harm. That has been successful in some of the other cases, but in Michael's, the judge said that you can't not talk about climate change at all in my courtroom because you might mislead the jury into believing that climate change is happening and that was an excuse for what you did. That's the whole point of why I'm going to talk about climate. And so he had the most famous climate scientists in the country were there in the courtroom, and they weren't allowed to say anything. I find that very emotional. I want to play just a little clip of what he said right afterwards, right after he was found guilty.
Starting?
Okay,
good morning. I don't know what I'm supposed to say right now. My thoughts are just kind of taking shape and developing, coming into focus. The world looks a little different to me this morning, and I think it's in a good way. I think that I'm getting some clarity about what we're up against, and it's really not about the legal system in criminal defense trials. And it's not even about, it's not even quite about teaching climate science, which is something that I've been volunteering to do for 13,000 plus people the last few years. There's an intergenerational injustice. And it's an emergency, and it's threatening our kids. They're in danger. As long as somebody like me can take action to protect my kids and yours and be instantly categorized as either a monster or our children's best or only hope, then our kids stay in danger. As long as I can be so polarizing just by doing the thing that I think most people would agree has to eventually happen anyway, you know, not relying on burning and polluting and digging stuff up. Nobody really wants that to be the way we live forever. So whatever you think about pollution or climate change or whatever it is, when and where is there ever a conversation happening about how we protect our kids and live well in this moment? When half the world, most of the world knows it's a crisis and we don't know how to fix it. The rest of us are just busy going about our lives, putting food on the table and working really hard, growing the crops. And until everybody gets together and says, yeah, we can do this differently quick, the kids stay in danger. So that's what I'm going to be cooking on for the next few weeks and months, is trying to open up a conversation before I face my sentencing, which is, sentencing was originally, they tried to put it on Martin Luther King Day. How perfect is that? I couldn't have asked for that honor. But that's what they did because their calendar didn't have the holidays on it. It's a federal holiday, so I'm going to be sentenced on Thursday after Martin Luther King Day, and that works for me.
It'll likely be around a 20-year sentence, rest of his adult life. So the last thing I want to say before we have a little bit more of a conversation about where this fight is right now, is I'm reminded of this very famous picture. Does anyone know about this? And this is in India. This was a protest at the Darasan Salt Works. Gandhi, a little bit earlier from that, broke the salt law. The salt law said that Indians weren't allowed to pick up salt off their own land because it was owned by Britain. They could collect it, give it to the British would process it, and then they would buy it back for a high tax. And in Gandhi's protest and fight for self-rule, there's a very famous picture of him, you know, leaning down and picking up that salt for the good of his people. And he was put in jail, and then afterwards there's this huge crowd, and they walked for hundreds of miles to get to this salt works, and they lined up in front of the salt works. And one person would walk up at a time, and the British would beat them with a steel bar cracker, and people would come up and drive them away. And the next person, nonviolent protest, next person walk up, and hundreds of people were beaten in this one protest, and it lasted days and days. And I feel like we're all in that crowd somewhere. Some of us may be closer to the front, and some of us may be further at the back. And like at the very back of it, I imagine Scott Pruitt being like, I'm not part of this. But climate change is coming for everybody, right? When, you know, no matter how much money you have. And so I feel like we're all a part of this climate action. So my question for you, before we have that kind of choose your own adventure, we can talk about a lot of different things about climate change, is just kind of where you feel like you are in this action. Where do you feel like you are in this action? Are you near the front? You're doing everything that you can? Are you kind of in the middle? You're still learning? Or you feel like you're in the back? Like, I'm not really part of this yet. Can you guys talk at your tables a little bit about that? Where are you in climate action?
Right.
structure, which one starts with personal steps, master of another of the personal steps.
Yeah, maybe the goal isn't to the front, maybe it's to the like more cultural
aspects.
Some Patagonia, I think, is
Let's stop there. I'm sorry if I'm cutting a few people off. I think we'll have a little bit of time to talk together again. I heard some common themes at the different tables about how there's so many different issues to focus on. It's hard to make this one of them. Let's stop there with thinking about action for a minute and hear from you guys about what do you want to hear more about. We could talk about what are the impacts on this region. We could talk more about individual actions, what people can do. We can talk more about some of the things being done to mitigate climate change.
I want to hear about other people's conversations or maybe just on topic or not your topic before. But yeah, I'd like to hear conversations about other people's topic.
So we had the kind of what is climate justice, ideas on that, or ideas on, you know, where are you in your action? Where do you feel like you fit in? Any of those?
Any of those?
Yeah. Or if anyone wants to kind of summarize what the table is talking about.
So we talked about climate being a large picture, a large ball of wax, so to speak, right? And there's so many different parts to it. There's trees, there's animals, there's polar bears, there's pollution issues. It just goes on and on, all the various aspects that this comes under. So the question is, where can we give our individual talents have the most impact? How do we get hooked into that organization, that movement, so we can make an impact? It's just sometimes I think a lot of people feel overwhelming. Where do I put my toe in the water to begin my contribution to climate justice? And so that's where I am. It's like, where can I be most effective?
Yeah, that's a great point. The last slide I'll share with you guys is a list of different organizations and groups that are kind of fighting this fight. Let me see if any of those speak to you.
What about this table?
Well, related to what Alan was just saying, in our last conversation, we talked a lot about how we deal with where we are in the fight. Like, we all kind of work in the middle, that individually we're doing a lot of personal choices or doing a lot of things in our personal lives that helping, doing our part, but then thinking about that's just us. How do we get closer to that front line or move it, every one of us?
Well, we didn't really get a chance to have that deep of a discussion, but in terms of, so from my own perspective, I think that I kind of fall in the middle. Looking at it more critically, I think that in a lot of ways, maybe a lot of us fall in that middle because it's kind of like, well, are we going to risk, you know, like our jobs or like our responsibilities, or do we have that capacity to do that? That's one thing. Also, looking at climate justice from in comparison to like low-income communities. So, for example, at Seattle University, I know that they have banned selling water bottles or like plastic bottles, like for pop or juice and things like that. But then, from my own like point of view, like when I was a student, I couldn't. I really wanted like a hydro flask, for example, because like they stay cold all day. But at the time, like I couldn't afford like a $20 or $30 water bottle. So if I were going to Seattle U and I wanted some water, I would have to find other ways or like always make sure that I'm close to a water fountain. I don't know if like everyone's kind of following that because I'm like, but. So yeah, like thinking about working in like, or like not even working in, but like if you're coming from a low income community, it's like, what can you afford, you know, to contribute at least in that way or something like that. So yeah.
You talked like, you know, more or less about, you know, other people's talk about, and we can jump in. And, I think we were like speaking to talk about that, you know, how on an individual level these, you know, the damages that are done to the environment are like hidden. So like, you know, I don't burn coal outside, you know. I don't like, you know, burn plastic bags, but somebody's doing it for me. And you know, I don't like build my own car, you know, like I just buy it, you know, so we just in the factory wasted like, you know, how that actually happened. So I feel that, you know, like there's a whole system, you know, built around hiding, you know, that kind of consumers, you know, who are like the majority, you know, who are actually buying those things.
Mm-hmm.
And like, you know, how do you go about that? You know, how do you go about telling people, in a society where, you know, you see like, you know, Mercedes or, you know, Maserati, you know, showing their ads on TV and, you know, in a way like telling teenagers especially, like, or like, you know, younger people to like, you know, open up five businesses and start to mainstream your life. Like, you know, how do you like go about that? But we all felt, you know, like we were in the middle crying, you know, individually, but, you know, feeling helpless that we're not able to make a big change.
Yeah. It's hard to keep up with, you know, 50 environmental rules overturned in less than a year. It's hard to have individual actions that kind of meet that challenge. You guys maybe think of one study that was done recently. That showed, this is in Science, that showed the economic impact of different regions by 2100. And I think in this region, we will continue to have this feeling of not a huge sense of urgency because it's not going to affect us that poorly. People are moving to this region. Our economy is booming because we have mild weather. We're not going to have major hurricanes. We will have shifts in our climate here, but it will not be devastating. Earthquake, that's another issue. But in terms of the climate, it won't be devastating. So I also feel like I feel pretty comfortable. Like there's a lot to consider before you move forward on that action. Yeah. So this is just showing out the places that are darker colored here have more of an economic impact.
Examples of that would be like in Florida, crops of oranges were destroyed because of unexpected snow or something like that.
Yeah. So let's just talk about some of those impacts. If that's okay, is everyone tired of hearing all these, or can I take a few moments? I just wanted to show this because this is from NOAA, which thank God still exists, even though it's been significantly defunded, and government scientists have not very many people to speak to in power anymore, but we are still creating these plots. And I don't want to look at the specifics here, but just to show that this is in 1 month and it's global. You have global anomalies outside the norm. what are some of the big ones that you heard about recently? Of course, Harvey put more rain taller than me on Houston in just a few days. And who suffers in these kinds of instances? It's not the people that are in nice homes, in the nicer neighborhoods, that they could just lose that home and move to another home in another area. It's the people who are in the flood zones, who cannot get flood insurance, where there's only developments there because we have removed regulations that disallow homes to be built in those areas. Who are the people affected? The people who can't get to work and they're living paycheck to paycheck. It's always low-income people who are facing the brunt of the impacts, right? So Houston will be reeling for years after this. Puerto Rico is not supposed to get power back at 100% for a year. Farmland flooded. These are livestock that all got it. They're facing mass emigration. People just leaving. I mean, why would you stay there if you don't have a job there anymore? And another one we hear a lot locally. I'll just gonna share a few other ones. We hear a lot locally, but they had a huge monsoon season in Southeast Asia this year. The number of people affected in India, Nepal, and Bangladesh. 32 million people in India affected. Hundreds of thousands of houses are lost. It's a huge amount of flooding. Why is it flooding? Because there's more water in the atmosphere now, about 10% more water in the atmosphere now, so whenever it rains a lot harder. So huge monsoon season. We see people, you know, just trying to get around, basically swimming where they need to go. It affects people because it washes out their farmland. So you said with Florida, a million people lost their homes and no longer have access to their food supply. That famous home, water, water everywhere, not a drop to drink. This boy is trying to pump water. He's surrounded by a flood of contaminated water because of chemicals that might be there or fecal toxins that might be there that are now in that water. So no water, no food. And limited transport. This is a flooded airport near Manila. So, those issues. Bangladesh, right now, I feel, like I said, I feel pretty comfortable in Seattle. Things aren't that bad in Seattle, but right now, people facing devastating hunger in Bangladesh. And Bangladesh just got half the Rohingya population. I don't know if anyone's following that mass exodus out of Myanmar. But devastating hunger from damage to farmland. Just a few others. Chemical waste that's flooded into the streets, you get chemical burns from walking around your neighborhood. Philippines had a monster typhoon season this year. This is an emergency room that was flooded in multiple large typhoons. And then fires, you guys were here this summer, a terrible summer. Air quality got so bad that people's health was affected, and even people who were healthy were told not to go outside and exert yourself. Huge wildfires in Florida right now. And again, internationally, well, we don't see that much. This was Australia this year. Fires everywhere, right? So they've also had a massive drought. And the thing is, what I want to end with on the impacts, is just that isn't climate change. Like, that climate change made those things a little bit worse. Makes things a little bit worse. But what we see from the scientists is that this is 1 degree Celsius warmer. So the warning is 1.5 is where we get really bad, where things get really bad. And we're probably going to get up to 3 before we can really put the brakes on our carbon emissions. And so things will get much, much, much worse. It's just like a little bit of a preview. And so I also hear what you guys are saying about action. And, you know, we feel pretty comfortable in this region. We have big decisions to make to figure out where we are in that fight. And that's something that I am doing every day. So I'm really glad to be able to, we only have a few minutes left, to have this conversation with you guys to try and figure out where I am, how I stack myself up against those millions of people that are displaced in other regions that are on the front lines of climate change, who didn't have a choice about getting involved, and now they're just, now it has to be their fight. Now they're in that march too. We have a few more minutes. What else are you guys interested in with climate change? What else are you guys feeling?
So how do we make this an issue that the wealthy care about? Because while we say it's going to affect everyone, I don't believe that. I think the wealthy are insulated, but we are comfortable. And they don't feel it, and they're profiting off of things that are causing it. So how do we make this an issue that they care about?
Because all the money, like the effects in the pocketbook, that's what's going to affect them, and they'll hopefully make changes based on their economic bottom line. So these storms are destroying people, agricultural land, probably have some effect. But the mechanism of that, I don't know how one looks at. That's a bottom line.
I have something on a similar topic. So I was reading that in Puerto Rico, Tesla, you know, is volunteering that, oh, we want to set up our electric grid here.
Uh-huh.
It seems like maybe like a curse, you know, in a boom, because, you know, on the one hand, it's going to be renewable energy, but on the other hand, you know, like you are giving this, you know, one corporation, like power, like electricity, or generate, you know, for a whole, you know, island. So I was wondering if people have thought about that, you know, and they think it's a good idea, bad idea, should be regulated. But it was like, you know, kind of what Al was saying, that, you know, oh, you have to make money somehow to make the change.
Talking about politics, but I'm going to be out there in November. I'm going to be talking to people and turning red because I feel embarrassed and I don't really know the right words or who the people are. But be out there, kids. Well, you got to think about who we're voting for. And so I'll show this last slide. Like I said, I have about 100 slides here, but I'll just show this last one of these different organizations. And this is so tiny, which is really annoying. This was part of the handout. It's impossible to see. This was part of the handout that I gave after the film, and I've just been like accosting people in the street. Information about climate action, you know. And so one of the big ones, I think, is just 350.org. It's one I really enjoy, just kind of keeping up with what they're talking about. It's easy to remember, 350.org, and they have a chapter in Washington, and that's helpful for me, especially for our next round of voting. I've realized how important our local elections are, and we have some big carbon-related projects coming up, like a big methane plant near Tacoma, and coal export terminals, things like that. So.
I think someone mentioned it earlier. I can't quite remember. But so what advice can you give to us, or like what can we do like in our everyday lives? I mean, thinking about it, it's like I know some of my friends, for example, have decided to like eat differently.
Yeah.
And not support like meat industries, or they thrift because, you know, like so much, like a humongous amount of clothes is just tossed everywhere.
Right, yeah.
So
there's so many little things that you can do. Of course, I have a slide for this. I have a whole section of this called My Journey from Extraordinary to Average, and extraordinary is where we are in the US with our high carbon emissions. And how do we get down to 5 tons per person per year, which is the global average? And how do we get down to two big numbers? And it's one of those people. So justice, when you do the math for 2050, is 2 tons of carbon per person per year. How do we get down to two? It's going to be pretty extreme. We're like looking at Afghanistan there, how they live in Afghanistan. And so if you go to this carbon calculator, coolclimate.berkeley, if you just type cool climate, you'll come up with it. There's a carbon calculator, and it gives you this huge long list for things that you can do. I love to do this in my class because often the things that we hear about doing are really insignificant, and there's some really big things that we can do they're easy things, and they have a big impact. So in this thing, which I don't have time for, I just kind of talk about the last 10 years of my life, about how I've gotten down to 5. And I don't feel like I look that differently. Maybe I'm acting differently now, but I don't feel like I stand out in terms of my carbon footprint. So I think you can still kind of fit in and be kind of normal and live at 5. So yeah, 2 would be extreme. I'm on my way there. We haven't gone there yet. Thank you for that question. It's a cool climate. I highly recommend for everybody to keep track of your carbon emissions.
I'm going to echo your comments earlier about our democracy, because I think that is the elephant in the room, that we often want to make these personal choices, and they're important, I think, for us to feel like we're doing something. But I think at the end of the day, it's going to come down to our political systems and who has power and who's making decisions. And right now, those people are not necessarily all making decisions in the best interests of common citizens. And so if you can get politically active and just, you're not a politically active person, at least know who you're voting for and research and do the good work of a citizen and find out who you're putting in elected office and what that team all through the farm, right? So I want to echo your comments about how important that is.
I think
they want to see
TV consumer to water situation. Before I started working here, 2 years before that, and if anyone was here, please tell me the names. Student leadership. And this was a result of the learning community's topic, which was water. Student leadership, student leaders got the administration and auxiliary services to stop selling bottled water on their campus. And they actually, it was like a big deal that they had to make. They were going to sell water bottles to students and give part of the profits to make up for this amount of money that the school was losing as a result. And when I came here, I'm pretty sure there was no water sold on campus, no water bottles in the cafeteria or in any of the machines. And last year, or maybe the year before, I walked by and I was like, oh, that's gone. They're all full.